In December 1940, Sheffield was devastated by two nights of air raids. Multiple buildings were destroyed. Over 1,500 people were injured. Over 40,000 people were made homeless. And sadly, over 660 people lost their lives. Whilst Sheffield was being destroyed, a 10-year-old girl and her family were on the Wyburn estate, determined to survive. That 10-year-old girl was Mavis Turner, now 90 years old. Today, she sits down with us and tells us about the horrors her family saw and how she survived the Sheffield Blitz. So, what was life like before the war started? What were your daily routines? What would the day bring for you?
Well, life was wonderful. We were just young girls and just took every day as it came. We'd a nice, comfortable home on the Wyburn estate, and Mum and Dad and my sister and me. And then we were the my sister's birthday, actually, early September, and we had Neville Chamberlain declaring war, which we just thought, oh, is this exciting? You didn't know much about it, you see. And my sister was six then, and then these air raids started, and then when it got to the Blitz time, my dad was at work at Neap's End, and so he hadn't arrived home, and my mum got us down into the air raid shelter, which the air raid shelter Dad had dug out of this big deep hole, about 6 foot deep, and corrugated iron. And made it as comfortable. And then when the air raids came, they decided to put a couple of light beds in with old mattresses and that, you know, so that we could go in. So at night time, it would be a case of getting undressed, and he'd say about 8 o'clock, come on girls, up to bed now. And about, you'd just be putting light on to go upstairs, and this dreadful sound, the air raid sound came, and he right into your track siren suit, which Mum had made out of old coats and things, these siren suits that pulled up and there was a hood on, and you had to be bundled up. And then winter time, you can imagine how cold it was outside. But Dad wasn't at home, he was still at work at Neap's End. So Mum got us down into the shelter, and she'd left a big stew pot in the oven, a big, really big earthenware stew pot, and Yorkshire, typical Yorkshire range. And so we went into the air raid shelter. Well, it was an absolute nightmare. We could hear all this banging, and we could hear night. We lived near an army camp at Manor Lane, and you could even hear the sergeant shouting, and shall I swear, and fire, you buggers, fire, and there'd be planes coming over, you know, and the sound was unbearable at times. And so this particular night, on the night of the Blitz, my mum got us settled down in the, just the two girls, got us settled down in the air raid shelter, and nice and warm, and I old eiderdowns on us and things like that, and no sign of Dad coming home from work, and they eventually there were bombs dropping, and it was an absolute nightmare of it, but I always remember it, and even now I can still get a chill in my stomach when I hear it. Something that just reminds me of it, you know, and that's going a long time, isn't it?
Was that the point of the war where it dawned on you how serious it was?
It was, yes, it becomes scary. Yes, yes,
yeah.
You see, by then I'm about 10 and a half, I think, something like 31, I was born. Yeah, going into 10 years old anyway. And, it was very frightening. And so eventually, mum's sat knitting there. She always knitted socks for soldiers. And she kept thinking, oh, this wool's a bit sticky. And when it came to, there were a mouse nibbling the wool in the air raid shelter. But she carried on, just to keep her mind occupied, because my dad wasn't there, you see. Anyway, the sirens went off, the old clear went off, and this would probably be about 6 o'clock or something like that, but you'd to stay in the shelters. What air raid wardens were coming round, they were so brave coming round, you know, telling you what to do and everything. And apparently, we didn't know it at the time, but an incendiary bomb had dropped in our backyard. And the next door neighbour, because there were, you know, proper council houses, he saw it happen, and he ran across the yard and picked the dustbin up and tipped the contents and everything over the incendiary bomb to stop it from flaring up, you see. Yes, and so most kids didn't know about that then at the time, but anyway, about 7 o'clock in the morning, you still had to stay in your shelters, and we had Dad's voice in the passageway as he's coming up. Oh, we were so relieved, you know. Oh, and it was absolutely marvellous. And so Mum went probably Dad, we've got some contraption of a table, and we brought this big pot of stew, really big one, and got it in the middle, and a load of bread, and we were all dunking the bread in and spooned out of the same bowl, because you'd not room for anything else. And anyway, after that, there was still quite a lot left. And so my mum called next door neighbours, and this is the man who saved the incendiary bomb from going off, because they used to flare up, you know. And she said, Billy Webster, there's pot of stew here if you want it. We've all had what we want out. And he took it to their shelter. That's how primitive it had to be, you see.
They were a real community spirit.
Oh, absolutely.
Everybody pulled together.
Yes,
and...
yes, yeah. But you see, then, as it started to get on, Dad's voice, as I'd said, oh, so we're hugging each other, and thank goodness, and my mum gave him some food and everything, but we're still in the shelters. And then some air raid wardens came round and said, right, everybody out, there's a landmine in the back garden. This, we lived in the junction of Southend Place. Southend Road was a back road overlooking where all the fields were, where the camp was. And he says, there's a bank, there's unexploded landmine in so-and-so garden, so you've all got to get out and get down to Wyburn School, which was a good walk down, and because that was on the older estate and on the Cricketing Road area. And so we all the neighbours trooped down there, all wrapped up in scarves and hoods and whatever we could, you know. And we went into this school, and there were volunteers there who were feeding people and making hot drinks for them and everything. And we were there for hours on end, because there were a few unexploded landmines had dropped. It wasn't just the one near us. And then one lady, she was going mad because her mother was bedbound and they hadn't been able to get her out of the house. And we're all looking out of the windows, and all of a sudden this hysterical sound from this poor woman, because we saw a house blow up, must have been one of these landmines. And of course she didn't know whether it was her mum's house or anything. So you can imagine the hysteria from that poor woman. It was absolutely awful. There were no fun to it at all. And anyway, after so long, during the morning, you know, mid-morning, they came and said, right, you can go back to your homes now. And of course, we had to walk up Moss Travers and Terrace and onto the top of the estate where we lived. And we walked into the house. But before that, all the with nice windows with an opening one, firm central one, and then an opening one at each side. And all the windows that opened were all slammed back against the outer walls. And some hadn't even broken, there were one or two broken, you know. But all the houses were like that. It had just slammed the blast from everything. Because another night when another bad raid was, when my dad was just lifting me into the air raid shelter, and we could hear the sergeant shouting what he always shouted, fire, and they called it Big Bertha, this gun on this campsite, the biggest one. And my dad was down in the shelter, holding his arms up to lift me down, and we saw this plane. So he jumped out and we saw this plane, and it had been hit, and it was diving, and we could hear it diving, and it landed in Norfolk Park, German plane. So that was Thursday night. So Friday night, and Friday night we all went to bed as we hoped we could. And the raid wasn't too bad on Friday night, but on the Saturday morning we could see towards Boundary Road from where we lived, and Hazelhurst Road was the one leading up to Boundary Road, and we saw all our relatives. My dad was the eldest of eight children, and so we saw some of my younger uncles and aunties walking on the road to us, a great crowd, and we're dreading what had they come to say, you know, because the grandma lived in a big house at Upperthorpe at the time, and some were still living at home. And they came on and they said, my mum says you've got to pack cases and you're coming to live at ours. So imagine, my sister and I ended up in Grandma's double bed with her, and their little bedroom were given to Mum and Dad, and then Uncle's, they slept in attics and things and got everybody organised. And Grandma says, right, we've all gone through a terrible ordeal. We're going to have a nice Sunday tea. And she did what she could, because the food were rationed, you know. And my mum had taken down what food we'd got. And so we all sat down to Sunday tea, and the sirens went again. And that was the Sunday night blitz. When we left the Wyvern to go to Upperthorpe, Grandma lived in a big old house at the back of some shops, and you went up a flight of steps to Grandma's front room. And as I say, she'd got a big family. And so she got a shelter that was reinforced down in the cellar. And in the cellar, there were all steel bars across and steel girders and the bar, steel rods holding the roof up and that, and quite a big shelter. And they made some beds up in there for us children, you see. And of course, as I say, my dad was the eldest of eight, so the family were still at home, quite a few of them. And some went into the army, naturally. And so then there was another air raid on the Sunday night, and I think that's probably when they came to the steelworks. But they did a lot of damage there, yeah.
When you first ventured into the city centre, after all the air raids had happened,
yes,
was it worse than you expected, or how did that scene when you walked
worse,
in, far worse than what you expected to see?
Well, what I forgot to tell you was, as my dad was coming home, they managed to jump on a bus driver. Were you going, lads, and going into Sheffield, because they lived at, worked at Neats, well, come on. And their boss was with them, called Thomas Hancock, and they were saw makers. And poor Mr. Tommy, they all called him Mr. Tommy, you see. He vanished when they got off the bus. Walking on, and the bus driver said that. He vanished. When it came to, it slipped down a crater, a bomb crater. And sadly, it recovered, but mentally, we were very ill after that. We went to see him at his home, and it was a big posh house up at Ettlesfield, you know, Ettlesall rather. And, my dad always, a big memory with my dad was as they were running across the wicker, making the way home on that blitz morning. And there was a tram stood there that were burnt out. And he never forgot the fact that he saw the driver and conductress, because women had started working then, and they'd been running away from the tram. And the wires came down, and they were both laying dead on the floor. This was somewhere near the wicker, as I say, my dad had just walked from there. So that stuck with my dad as well.
We don't talk about the mental side of it. We always talk about the damage what happened to buildings.
Yes.
And people in air raid shelters,
yes.
But I think one of the things what's not spoke about is some of the images what people saw. How do you think people dealt with that? Especially yourself, you know, being in an air raid shelter, not knowing where your dad were, must have been
exactly.
Very...
Yes, yeah. Well, occasionally I can have an incident where I'll just get a funny irritation in my stomach, and then I go all cold. And I've tried to analyse it, and I thought, I know what this feeling is. It's when we used to hear the sirens going, and have to rush into the shelter. In fact, at one bit, when the air raids weren't quite too bad, Mum and Dad, my dad, they had a little pantry in the living room with a stone table. And they cleared all the floor and they put some sort of mattress or eider down there. And my sister and I went and slept in that pantry. And Mum and Dad would sit, you know, lay on the settee at night and keep an eye on us. But they were very protective, my parents. And and we used to sleep like that because it was under the stairs, you see. So it's, and then there's a thing under the, that was under the bedrooms. There was another little cubby hole in the kitchen, and that was where the stairs were running up, sloping roof, and they put a bed down there as well, so they were able to sleep in one. We were sleeping in pantry. But honestly, it was awful. But we didn't, as I say, we lived at Grandma's for quite a few weeks, and that's when the Sunday night blitz happened. Yeah, that's the blitz as far as little things come back to you, you know, but they were the main incidents. Those two blitz nights were terrible, you know.
You said that your father saw some awful scenes on the wicker.
Yes, yes.
How did he deal with that afterwards?
Because that's very upset, very upset. And he used to be very quiet, and we used to think, well, at the time we were kids, you see, but I've realised since, I bet he sat and thought a lot about seeing that all these dead people, and Marple's Hotel had gone down as well. But of course they were in the wicker, but they could see all the damage up, you know, as they were coming up through Haymarket and going over to the Wyburn estate. So my dad used to talk about it, but then he'd go right quiet and, just in his own world, just thinking about these terrible things that had happened. But, I mean, as I've told you this story, it seems such a short while, but it was something that went on all night and over a weekend as well, you see. So it was pretty bad.
In the years what followed the Blitz, whilst the war was still running its course, were you always kind of scared that you'd suffer another major air raid?
Oh, yes. Oh, we were always frightened of that, terrified of that. But somehow the powers that be had sorted themselves out and they fought back a lot. Because you see, as kids we didn't know that, but the war took a turn, and Churchill, ordered a lot of retaliation for it. But they were the two worst incidents that I can remember. But you know, when we're all in the school, there's a couple came in and they brought a big paper carrier, because everything were paper carrier bags in those days, clean paper carrier bags, with all beautiful bread cakes and a big pot of dripping, beef dripping. And all the kids had to queue up and all got a slice of this. And that was absolute nectar when you were stuck at this school. And
I can imagine.
Yeah, absolutely. So even to this day, if I saw a slice of bread dripping on the bread cake, dripping on, I think, oh, that was lovely.
What was your reaction like? Obviously, in 1945, you would have been around 15 years old.
Yes, yes.
When it was announced that the war was over.
Oh, yes, yeah. Well, the day that the war was over, I was working with my mum. We had a stall in Mexborough Market, and we'd been over there, and we used to have to come back. I think we used to catch a train into Sheffield, and everybody's talking about, looks like being the wolves being over, you know. And we came home, and my mum, if she was a brilliant provider, if she could get anything, even she managed to get meat. But you see, she worked in the market, so she looked after people who, like somebody who works at a butcher's and things like that. There were a lot of that went on, you know. And then she'd say, run up to Co-op or Poisers, they were shops on the Wybanassee, and get 2 pennyworth of pot herbs, which was carrots, a turnip, celery top, everything. And she'd make a big stew and with the meat that she'd managed to get. Just to keep us all going, you see. But the rations weren't very good. But that's going off the story, isn't it? But it's all part of what was happening in those days, you know. And then after that, the air raid sort of, they were still bad at times, but not as bad as the Blitz and the Sunday night episode, yeah.
So the first time you went into an air raid shelter,
yeah,
what did that feel like when you first heard them?
Claustrophobic, yeah, because it's, imagine a about where that radiator is, length of the air raid shelter, and then it's all closed in, and there's a little square where they'd have to stand down and lift us down and, you know, get us comfortable. And the front garden here always had it, beautiful carnations and everything. You had to dig all that up and plant potatoes. Everybody had to plant vegetables in the gardens, you know, and dig for victory, we're called. I think we just sort of got on with life. My school was bombed. I was at Manor Lane Council School, which is on City Road and Manor Lane corners, and that was bombed, and so that was shut down for years. I think it's open again now, but from there we had to go wherever we could, and we went across to a brand new Catholic school in South End Road, and that was the best years of my life in that Catholic school. But then from there I passed my you called 11 scholarship in those days, 11 plus. I passed my exams to go to a better school, you see. But the army camp was in a few fields away. In fact, our Sunday morning, on a normal Sunday morning, Dad would say, come on girls, get your coats on. And while Mum were cooking Sunday dinner, he took us a walk round the army camp, you know. And I always remember that after the Blitz, the King and Queen came up onto the, brought them up on the Wyburn, and they met a family of blind people who lived in the next road to us, you know. And that was a big event, and for the King and Queen to come when raids were bad as they were. But it was just after the Blitz when they did come. I've had photos and Joan, probably they're somewhere chucking about, but goodness knows where, love, you know. But in my own mind I can remember it, and I still get that icy cold feeling that sound of sirens did it. But then the old player, oh gosh. But you were stuck in your shelter for hours on end.
Is it something you get used to after a while, after you've gone into the shelter two, three, four times?
Do you get used to it?
Well,
it was part of your life, really. You see, you just had to get in, snuddle down and...
Mavis, it's been absolutely fantastic having you on.
Has it? Really?
Honestly, it's been really interesting. Good. And I'm sure all the people watching this are going to think the exact same thing.
Oh, thank you. That's very kind.
Thank you ever so much for your time. It's been so interesting.
I'm pleased that I could do it for you, because I don't suppose as many 90-year-olds have got a memory for one thing.
You're very good at remembering all that, to say it was 81 years ago.
It's because there were such big incidents in your life, lovely. You know, it sticks in your mind.
And I think that just shows the severity of it, because all these years later you can tell a story which paints a very clear picture to all of us what it was actually like.
Yes, you didn't know. Yeah, but it was horrendous, really horrendous.